problems in NCAA. Hold my grape juice. Like, the first two rounds of controversy that we had today was bad, but this has been... I don't know if COVID complicates things, but... I was thinking last night, this must be what it was like for UK fans all those years.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. official WMU mission retreat is Monday, September 12th, 6 p.m. here at East Frankfort Baptist Church. The cost is $11, but that does include a delicious dinner. So if you can do that, that's at 6 p.m. on September the 12th. The cost is $11. You can give that to Susan Hutcherson or Annette, and they'll get that where that needs to go. But you need to do that by Wednesday, so you have a head count. Also, you know what's coming up in a couple of months? Halloween. And you know what we do for Halloween for our outreach? Trunk or treat. And you know who never has enough candy for trunk or treat? East Frankfort Baptist Church. Can y'all fix that this year? I mean, come on. We've got a basket out there. Next time you're at you see a great sale on individually wrapped candy, buy some and bring it, and we will give it away and minister to the community here at East Frankfort. So if you can do that, that would be super great. All right. Our deacon of the week here is Ed Stewart. He's going to give us a little scripture reading this morning.
Happy to be here this morning. Last week I was in a different church of McGillion, as you know, and I'd like to request something off you before I read the scripture today. Pray for the Bible. We gave out 800 at Kentucky State University last week, and we gave out 8,000 at the University of Kentucky this week, Wednesday. I was amazed the kids, they were taking on Bibles. And remember, God says in Isaiah 55:11, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. They shall not return void, but they shall accomplish what I please, and they shall prosper in the things whereto I sent them. So pray that those kids would accept the Bible, would read them and find Christ in accepting those Bibles. And so I'm happy to be here this morning. What I'd like to read today is from 1 Corinthians 3, verses 9 through 17. For we are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building. If you realize our body is God's building when you get saved. If you are born again, blood washed with Christian, God lives in you. For know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have of God? 1 Corinthians 6:9. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yes, not I, but Christ liveth in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Galatians 2:20. Christ in you, the hope of glory, Colossians 1:27. God lives in us, for in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are completed in him. In other words, if you have Christ living in you, you've got the Father, you've got the Holy Spirit, the Trinity living in you. So this verse is saying that we are God's husband. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me, a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed as to how he builds. For other foundations can no man lay than that which is laid by Jesus Christ. Now if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, and precious stone, wood, hand, stubble. See, when we die, our soul and spirit goes to heaven. But in time, we're going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ. And the books are going to open the way you live in that. And if you live in more by the flesh and not by the spirit, it's going to be wood, hand, stubble. There would be some Christians actually who have the tears wiped from their faces. They're not going to enjoy heaven like some will. But if you've been doing like the Gideons, we gave out all those Bibles. That's throwing up treasures in heaven for me. I love to do that kind of thing. I parked out there. Some may have seen my car at 5:30 in the morning last Wednesday. And the brothers picked me up from Lexington and they drove me all the way to the campus, University of Kentucky. The Christian organizations on that campus fed us breakfast. And we descended on that campus and they gave out all those Bibles. So that's building up. That's what they mean, building gold and silver and precious stone. If every man, what shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare kept me from doing it. Plus, I was blessed to have a father. Never forget him. He didn't have any formal education. He built the home that I lived in Mobile, Alabama. That house is still living there. We would bring little books home. He would learn how to measure stuff. But the big thing is after him saying that song, I used to give him a nail, give him a hammer. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died up on the tree. I know it was the blood for me. My father got me started toward the Christian faith. My mother was just as tough. She would sing this song and she would be washing clothing with a big black kettle. We had to put wood and coal and burning. And she put a little can of lye into that water. It had a picture of the devil on in a red Union suit. I don't see how we survived as I think about it. So we had to get the water from a well. It had little tadpoles in it. And when we would drink that water, we'd put it in for the but she would be singing that song. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Born in the spirit, washed in his blood. And that got me thinking about how important his blood was. From hearing my mother sing that song. And she would take a broom handle and take that clothing out of that water and put it on the line. So you need to be saturated with it. Our bodies is a temple of God. When you think about drinking liquor, smoking tobacco, with Christ living in you, Christ in you, the hope of glory, you got the Father living in you, if you got Christ in you, you got the Holy Spirit living in you, so don't defile the temple of God. As a matter of fact, that closing verse makes it plain. And this is a warning to us Christians. If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. But the temple of God is holy. It's that song we just sung. He's a holy God. He's the temple of God. And we're his temple. You have to be real careful what you do. Can you imagine me smoking a stogie with Christ living in me? None of my wife is going. Can you think of me getting with a harlot with Christ living in me, taking Christ to a harlot? That's in the Bible. So you live a clean Christian life. Be careful how you live, for Christ is living in you. Father, I just thank you for the word of God. I thank God I go to the church where the word is respected. I pray for Pastor as he comes today. May his voice hold in strong power. Save the lost today, Father, with your word. Save that soul as near as hell. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Draw me near. was presented at his funeral and all the shells that were in there, some pictures of her and her husband. And through all this, our campus minister, Matthew, actually was able to present the gospel to Bud, the neighbor, and he ended up being saved there that day. And so it was truly an amazing day. You could just see the Lord working in the hearts of others around us, the hearts of the ones working, because it was an amazing time just being able to serve others, and you could just tell that the Spirit was present. Because we were also given a leader in our group. His name is Paul, and he works, he's part of the KBC Disaster Relief Team. And he told us that truly the only thing there he wanted us to try and get done, our one goal for that day, was to just get the stuff out of the house. But we went beyond that. We got the stuff out of the house. We were able to go through the stuff we saved and find the stuff that we could get back to the lady who lives there. We took the floors up. We cut out the walls down to the studs, and we're able to clean it up to where now another team can go back in and clean up the building. And hopefully she can move back in once she recovers. But truly, it was an amazing day, and I thank you all for giving to the KBC and helping us, because without churches like you all that love others, we wouldn't be able to do stuff like this, go on a mission trip and be able to help people. So thank you all.
Yeah. sing. We'll sing for you in a few months, but we'll see what we can do.
Chosen,
His I will be, and with him I will remain. And again, whom shall I serve? Should it not be his son? As I have served your father, so I will serve you. Then Absalom said to Ahithophel, give your counsel, what shall we do? Ahithophel said to Absalom, go into your father's concubines, whom he has left to keep the house, and all Israel will hear that you have made yourself a stench to your father, and the hands of all who are with you will be strengthened. So they pitched a tent for Absalom on the roof, and Absalom went into his father's concubines and signs of all, the sight of all Israel. Now in those days the counsel of Ahithophel was as if one consulted the word of God. So was all the counsel of Ahithophel esteemed both by David and by Absalom. Our Father, we are looking at a difficult text to understand, to apply to everything. Lord, we ask that you would, as always, open our entire being that we may receive your word, be transformed by it, believing that your Spirit will give it to us and that we will be more like Jesus. Would you be so kind? May I decrease so that you can increase. In your Son, we pray. Amen. See you. Well, Israel is officially at war. And they've been at war really since chapter 15. And what we see in chapter 16 is picking up on that narrative. Absalom is marching to Jerusalem with an army. And instead of standing to fight for his kingdom, David flees. And he is literally in exile in the wilderness. Now in chapter 15, just to remind you, last week we saw that as David flees, he makes his first of several encounters. And in chapter 15, these are largely positive encounters. For example, there is one gentleman who, even though he's only been on the job for one day, decides that he will be loyal to David and only loyal to David, and so agrees to go into exile with the now former king. So too, he has been able, through the connections and loyalty of some of his servants, he has set up a spy ring inside Absalom's administration. We actually see some of that with Hushai there in chapter 16. He also has connections among the high priests, and they will keep a line of communication between what is going on in Jerusalem with his son and everything else. So in chapter 15, there's some positive coming out of it, right? Yes, David might be in exile, but there's some reason to think that this war will soon turn. When you come to chapter 16, David is still going through a series of encounters, but these are more negative encounters. One after another, here David, in the middle of dark times, people heap scorn and betrayal upon him, adding insult to the proverbial injury. Let's start here, verses 1 through 4. We meet the opportunist. The opportunist, in the end, adds David's sense of abandonment. Here in verse 1, we meet that David meets a man by the name of Ziba, who is the servant of Mephibosheth. Now, those names may not jump off the page to you, but we've met these two guys before. You go back a few chapters, you may recall that when David set up his kingdom, he went out of his way to seek out anyone from the household of Saul. Saul, of course, being the previous king who was ousted by David, essentially, as an oversimplification, but we'll run with it. Now, usually, when the incoming king is seeking to find out, is there anyone left related to the previous king and has a legitimate legal right to the throne, usually that means the current king wants to kill all of them, right? You just want to wipe them off because you don't want any sense of illegitimacy attached to your reign. Well, word got around that one of Saul's sons, the only surviving son of the former king, was still alive. His name was Mephibosheth. Now, Mephibosheth, we are told, was handicapped and was limited in his ability to provide for himself. Instead of seeking Mephibosheth out to execute him, as most ancient Near Eastern kings would have done, David seeks him out to show him great kindness. He brings Mephibosheth into his home. He says, you have complete access to the palace. Come share a meal with me anytime you want. In fact, he says, due to the limitations as a result of your handicap, he restores to Mephibosheth all the land of his father, the late king. And with his servants, Mephibosheth has some wealth and provisions given to him. His chief servant was this Ziba. And so when David is marching away from Zion, as he is entering into the wilderness, into exile, east of
of Jerusalem, he meets Ziba, and immediately he knows something is up. He should not see Ziba without Mephibosheth being with him. So David wants to know, what in the world is going on here? And what Ziba does is he brings with him supplies, if you will. At least it'll be perceived as supplies. It's presented there as donkeys, bread, raisins, fruits, and wine. And these were for David, his men, their families, and everyone else traveling. Now, David probably assumes this is produce from Mephibosheth's field, and it is. It is Mephibosheth returning the favor. David showed him kindness. Here's Mephibosheth showing David kindness. But Ziba, verse 3, suggests otherwise. Ziba tells us that no, Mephibosheth has betrayed you. Mephibosheth is celebrating that Absalom is taking the throne because he believes Absalom will return Saul's kingdom back to the descendants of Saul. Now, imagine being David. David has no reason to believe that this is wrong. After all, again, put yourself in his shoes. If you have been exiled by your own son, who is grown in popularity, no doubt you probably assume that what Ziba is telling you is true. After all, Mephibosheth has everything to gain with David being ousted than he does with David staying. If Mephibosheth wants power, and every prince does, then it makes complete sense why Mephibosheth would do this. Now, we will find the full story later on in 2 Samuel, but for now, David believes everything Ziba is telling him. Ziba, you see, is an opportunist. He is heaping upon David, taking advantage of his emotional state of rejection, saying, "You have been abandoned even by those you loved and treated well." But Ziba, we find, is the real opportunist here. He is essentially bribing David and taking advantage of his weakness and this weak state that he is in for his own good. By bringing all of this produce, by bringing all of these supplies, he manages to get David to take away from Mephibosheth his land and instead give it to Ziba. No wonder then, there at the end of this passage there, verse 4, Ziba said, "I pay homage. Let me ever find favor in your sight, my lord the king." And the irony is, Ziba says he is loyal, the thing that he said Mephibosheth is not. But in fact, he would do the same thing to any king if he can get what he thinks he deserves. He is an opportunist. And opportunists are self-interested. Ziba couldn't care less about Mephibosheth and his needs, nor could he care about David. He only cares about himself. It is sad when people see misery and suffering as an opportunity not to serve, as Jacob shared earlier, but rather for personal gain. Every time there is a natural disaster, for example, in Kentucky, the Attorney General has to announce, "Beware of scammers. Beware of people who will make victims of those who are already been victimized." This has been true recently with the flooding in eastern Kentucky. It was true earlier with the tornadoes in west Kentucky. It is incredible the evil that such opportunists will practice. We meet not only an opportunist, but we also meet an opponent here in verses 5 to 14. If Ziba brings a sense of abandonment to David, here, this man brings to David a sense of rejection. They continue to go into exile. They continue to leave the promised land, and suddenly this guy gets off his keyboard and he starts to shout across the street at David. And here he heaps scorn and abuse upon him. Shimei, we find in verse 5, curses at David and his men continually. Here's a man who loves schadenfreude. That is a word you didn't know you were going to hear this morning, right? Right? You know you're going to get some German. But here it is, right there. That I went to school for that. Google didn't spell it right and everything. But he revels in David's misery, believing he is getting what he deserves. In fact, notice verses 6 to 7. He even throws stones at David and his servants, so much so that his bodyguards have to surround him. This is the king. This is the king. And this guy isn't just heaping insults at him, but he is throwing stones at him. So naturally, we can agree this man should not be canceled on Twitter. We can all agree on that, right? But verse 7, notice that he is cursing David again, and he calls him a man of blood who is worthless. Worthless. Again, put yourself in David's shoes. You've been ousted by your own son from a throne you believe that Yahweh himself has gifted you as the anointed one of Israel, thrown out of the city. Everyone wants you gone, and along the way, in your lowest point in life, this was lower than anything he experienced in the time of Saul when he was on the run. Here comes this one person to say, those whom you showed kindness to have abandoned you. Here comes another man who says, who rejects him, his leadership, and everything about him, and continues to heap insults. Now, if you're David, what would you do? We're given two good options. I know which one I would probably pick. It's not the right option. Probably the one I would pick, though, right? The first option, we need to skip down to verse 9, and that is violence. Notice there, then Abishai, son of Zeruiah, said to the king, why should this dead dog curse my lord of the king? Let's go take off his head. Now, that's probably the option most of us would pick in the ancient Near Eastern world, right? Now, think about it. When was the last time we saw a story where the words a dead dog and curse were found in the same narrative? Oh, and it had to do with David. Remember the story? There was not a man who was a giant. He was cursing Israel, and he looked at David and says, am I a dog that you throw a stick at? And what did David do to that man? Chop his head off. I think the writer wants us to pick up here. Won't the giant slayer handle little Saul's buddy? Can he handle this? His servants certainly think so. In fact, he says, look, I know you can handle this dude, but let me handle it for you. You watch. I'll take care of this. And you will never have to hear these insults again. But what does David choose? He chooses patience. The humble man is willing to listen even to his critics in order to discern if there is any truth to discover. That is humble patience. Think about it. Most of us here can't handle a negative comment on a Facebook post, let alone a guy screaming across the street. It would be better if you were. David chooses patience. Why? Because David understands, even in the mockery and the hate of his worst critics, perhaps God is speaking. Now, don't misunderstand what I'm saying. We have a problem where people can heap praise, 1,000 people can heap praise upon us. One person can have one small word of negativity, and that's the only thing we heard that day. Because we personalize everything as Americans. We overhype critics, and we underhype the praise of people that we're supposed to love and who love us. It's amazing, isn't it? We hesitate to listen to those that we should listen to, and we listen only to people that we would never go to for advice. Isn't that strange? Why don't we do that? In a few minutes, I'll be right over here, and there will be nice comments made because you feel obligated to. But then there will be that one or two critic, right? And I'll go home believing that one person. I'm not saying do that. What I am saying is like a good joke, right? A good joke is one to where there has to be an element of truth to it in order for it to be funny, right? So when we make jokes about Louisville, jokes about Kentucky, jokes about the left, jokes about the right, jokes about deacons, jokes about in-laws, whatever it might be, they're only funny because of stereotype or some element of truth. So it is with criticism. Could it be there is an element of truth to what this critic has to say to David? For example, he calls David a man of blood. Is that true? God said it was. Remember when David was hanging out in his freshly built palace? He still had that new palace spell, right? And he looks down, he sees a little tent, and he says, that's where God is dwelling? That's not good enough for me. Hey, I've got an idea. Let's build a temple, a permanent dwelling space for our Creator. And God says, that is a great idea. You ain't going to do this. You are a man of blood. Think of all the fights David has had. Think of all the battles he's led his men into. Think of all the wars. And let's not forget, one of his men by the name of Uriah, he had executed so he can chase his wife around. There's some truth to this, isn't it? Now, what's not true is that David isn't worthless. David is full of worth. After all, he is the anointed one of God. So instead of saying, you know what, everything he's saying is true, you know, because all my critics are true, rather he says, look, the Lord will deal with him. In fact, we've got to move quickly, verses 10 through 11. David acknowledges that the Lord might be using him. And furthermore, verses 12 to 13, he leaves vengeance with the Lord. He says, yes, I don't like what this person is saying, but my identity isn't in criticism. It's not in the power of my opponents, but rather I understand God is just. He will address this in his own time. And remember what we saw last week. He says, if it's the Lord's will, I return to Jerusalem, then I will return to Jerusalem. In the meantime, I am in exile, and I must use this time to grow closer to Christ. And so in verse 14, he finally reaches his destination. He has crossed the Jordan. He and his men are exhausted, not just because they traveled nonstop, but because they are exhausted physically, they're exhausted emotionally, and certainly spiritually. But notice finally the order. So we've seen the opportunist, we've seen the opponent, here is the order. And when we get to this point, we think David is at rock bottom until we see just a hint of hope. This is broken down into two parts. Let me summarize. But first, we meet verses 15 to 19. Hushai is there. Remember, Hushai is the key spy for David. He's loyal to David, but he's pretending to be loyal to Absalom. By the way, his language is, he'll say, I'm loyal to the king, and Absalom assumes it's him because politicians are the most arrogant people you will meet. It's like college basketball and football coaches are the same. And so Hushai is there. But then we get this order, verses 20 to the end of the chapter. Absalom enters Jerusalem, and he takes the throne. And now he has to figure out what's next, right? That's the challenge of politics. Most presidents are either really good campaigners or really good administrators. You ever notice this? There are some leaders, presidents in particular, who you get them in their office, they are making decisions, we're doing this, I've got a vision, da-da-da. They're just going, they're in their zone. Turn a camera on, they're a deer in the headlights. Right? You know? Others, when they're behind the scenes and they're in charge of doing all that sort of stuff, they really struggle. They have to lean into to advisors and counsel and all that sort of stuff. And when you turn the cameras on, they are in vain, right? Really good campaigners. Some are really good administrators. Absalom has done a good job of the campaigning part. He's got everyone to back him up. He's got everyone to vote for him. There's no question of the election results here. And he just marches into Jerusalem. And now, what do I do? Well, you may remember one of his new counselors, a man by the name of Ahithophel. That name will be on your quiz. You have to pronounce it right and spell it right on the quiz at the end of service. He is the great traitor in the narrative. You have a spy in Hushai. You have a traitor here in Ahithophel. Yeah, let's see you do it. You remember for David, everything the man said was wise, but David prays, give him foolish counsel. The first thing he tells Absalom on the surface looks wise. Because after all, if you're going to oust David because he's not popular, presumably, you don't want to replace him with his son because he's just going to continue his dad's policies. But if he does this act with the concubines, remember David left his 10 concubines behind to maintain the palace. That was a big mistake we saw last week. If he does this, he will show publicly his policies, his administration will have nothing to do. So on the surface, it sounds politically wise. What he ends up doing is he makes a clear break with David personally, politically, publicly. This is the first of other examples of foolish word that matter? Because David is at his lowest here. Everyone has abandoned him. Everyone has heaped criticism and anger and taken advantage of him. David is at his lowest, far away from the palace. News hasn't reached him. He doesn't know what is happening. He is seemingly all alone on the other side of the Jordan. He is in the wilderness to the east, like Adam and Eve leaving the garden. All he has is a little bit of hope. We, the reader, are seeing it here, aren't we? Hushai is still there. The priests are still there. And oh, look, God is answering his prayers. This really stuck out to me this week. We, the reader, are seeing God actively partaking in what is happening here on David's behalf. But David hasn't seen any of that yet. Even at his lowest, David chooses to believe God is at work. Don't miss that. That's why when the opportunists come, he doesn't just get there. When his opponent is cursing him and throwing stones at him, he says, it's okay. It's okay. The Lord will work it out in the end. What is David at? David has fool's hope. I'll confess to you, I have spent most of this weekend watching the new Lord of the Rings show. Love Lord of the Rings. I'm a Tolkien fan, and if you don't like it, too bad. You have bad taste in literature, okay? That's what I think. Love it. Love it, right? May go home this afternoon. Watch it again. Love it. So good. I mean, they're going to ruin it, of course, but in the meantime, so good, guys. So good, right? I mean, it's going to get all woke and stuff. I don't like that. But outside of that, it's I love Tolkien's work. One of the great scenes is in Return of the King. I'm going to say this from the movies for the sake of simplicity. But Pippin is at Minas Tirith, and he's looking out at Mount Doom, Mordor. And he knows that the next day, everything they loved will be destroyed by the Dark Lord. And he says, I don't want to go into battle, which is a hobby. But waiting on the edge of one I cannot escape is even worse. Is there any hope, Gandalf? And the wise wizard says, there was never much hope. Just a fool's hope. Here's David. East of Israel. Outside of the Jordan. What hope is there for you, David? There never was much. I was a shepherd boy in Bethlehem. All I've had is but a fool's hope. But when God begins to move, it's more than enough. No matter how dark things get. If you don't believe me, you remember, we saw this last week, David's journey past the Jordan. He marched up to the Mount of Olives, and there he cried. His descendant, Jesus, followed the same path. And there he cried tears on the same mountain on his way to exile. He went outside of the city to be crucified. And if you were Peter, James or John or even Mary's there, witnessing the event. What hope did you have? What a fool's hope. Until 3 days later, at sundown, he was risen from the dead. Church, that's all we have. Do we worship a Savior who has conquered the grave? What darkness can his light not pierce? And how can we not, above all things, be a people of freedom? We will meet many opportunists. We will meet many opponents. We will always have the hope of a risen Savior. Let's go to the Lord. Father, I ask you to be so kind as to give us this hope. What a fool's hope. But a little hope. We don't know how our Christ is risen.